Mars cut. I'd like to start this evening's session by addressing a couple of questions that actually Anup raised offline. They're quite good questions, so I'll spend a little bit of time just addressing them first before we move on. So what Anup was asking is, there are of course ragas that are large, they're linear, you know, things like Yaman, Lyra, and so on, which are linear in nature. And then there are ragas that are large but non-linear. Things like Jai Jayavanti or Chayanat or Darbari, so on and so forth. There's lots of such ragas. And his question was, well, how do you apply the Dhrupad ala paradigm to performing these ragas? The thing to keep in mind is that even if a raga is non-linear, it has a set of sanchars that define the raga. And those sanchars can be ordered. And so in executing an alap, we have to keep a sense of a tonal center in mind as we're performing the alap. And the phraseology that is around those tonal centers is what we develop as a progressive process. So just as a demonstration, I better put this in airplane mode. Just as a demonstration, I'll take a little bit of China and show you what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Depending on how strong that Uttarang Pradhan-ness of the raga is, you have to keep hearkening back to the tonal center that's at the top. If the Vadi is in the Uttarang, then you have to keep hearkening back to that. And when you develop it, you have to show the nature of the raga immediately. You cannot start at the bottom and go up. So,
Yeah.
what we presented yesterday is a nominal paradigm for producing an halab and an halab. But you have to keep in mind the shape of the raga, the sanchars that are allowed in the raga, to keep in mind the vadi samvadi, to keep in mind the pace at which the raga is to be performed. You know, if I take an hour and a half to sing Sohini, if I, you know, 45th minute, you'll always be asleep. There's only that, it has a certain movement that you have to follow. And if you break that movement, then the Sohini-ness will disappear. So in singing Alap, it's not sufficient to start with Sa and then go to Re and Ga. And so that's actually a recipe for disaster if you don't keep in mind the rag and the demands of the rag. Is that clear? Any other questions on that? From anybody? So I think it's a good thing to use that as a jumping off point to discuss the notion of how this whole alap business has come to be, or how alap was thought of in past times. Alap was an essential aspect of Prabandhagan, the genre that is the precursor form of Dhrupad Dhamar. So, in that system of singing, there were three ways of doing alap. One was called ragala, one was called rupakala, and the third form was called alapti. There are three distinct ways of doing alap. But they nested in on each other. So, the essential aspect of it was ragala. Rupakala had all the features of ragala and then had a few exceptions that you could follow. Alapti had the features of ragala, rupakala, and a few exceptions that you could follow. In general, alapti was considered the least of the three. Ragala was the most important. So, there are 10 lakshanas given for how alap is to be designed. Those lakshanas essentially say that at the end of the process, one should have all of these characteristics of the raga evident as a result of listening to that. What are they? Graha, Nyasa, Amsha, Apanyasa. These four first. Graha, meaning the note from which you're starting. Amsha, meaning the note at which you're ending. Nyasa, the dominant note of the raga. Apanyasa, the subdominant note of the raga. So all of you will sort of realize that Nyasa Apanyasa, that concept is with us today as Vadi Samvadi. Graha has become a less important aspect of singing today, the point from which you depart. In general, we can depart from any note in the raga, but in the past that was not always the case. Nyasa, the note at which you land. It is a Vishranti Swara of the raga, a point at which you can finish a phrase and go and stop. Then, what should be evident at the end of listening to Nala is the aspect of Alpatva and Bahutva of each note. That is, the proportion with which a note has to be sung in the ala. Not all notes are to be taken the same. As is often the case with Dhrupad Alap today, this aspect is sometimes lost. But it's very important to keep in mind as you're singing which note is to be sung in what proportion. And it's not sufficient to say this is Vadi and Samvadi and the rest are Anuvadi. That's not the case. Even within the Anuvadis, particular notes take on particular weights in a raga. I like to sometimes think of a raga as being like a solar system with different planets that have different gravitational pulls. There are Mercuries, which are very small, they exert very little force on your position in the raga. And there are Jupiters, the Vadi of the raga is like a Jupiter, right? And then there are intermediate planets that have intermediate weights that will pull you in a certain way. And they cannot be considered to be less important than what the Vadi Samvadi are doing. In some rags, some of the anuvadis are just as important. So the idea of the weight of a note was an essential aspect of understanding the raga, even in the time of Sangeeta Ratnakar, which really describes the process of singing a prabandha. Then, a raga can take on a particular shape in the Madhya Saptak and look different in the Mandra Saptak and look different in the Tar Saptak. Not all rags look the same in the three sthayis of the scale. So, the characteristics of the Mandra Saptak and the characteristics of the Tar Saptak are part of the raga lakshanas that are required to be understood at the end of the naga. Finally, the idea of shadatva and audatva, meaning which note combinations can I extract from a raga and still retain the raganess? Which sequences can, what are the essential phrases that can be pulled out of the raga that define the raga without having to take all of the notes of the raga? These are the raga lakshanas of an alap. And although this is prescribed for raga alap in the Pravandagan, these are essential raga lakshanas to be followed in alap singing. Is there a question, Doctor? So, raga alap. So, ragala must include all of these 10 lakshanas. Rupakala ragala was prescribed for linear combinations. So, linear ragas that have scales that go up and down easily. Rupakala is prescribed for those ragas like Chayanat or Sohini, which have defined sanchars that must be followed. So, one cannot sing a ragalap in the sense that we just discussed. You cannot sing sa, re, ga, ma, pa, dha and all of these ragas. In a raga where that is not possible, you must retain the 10 raga lakshanas but show the sancharas that define the raga. Finally, alapti is that process of singing a ragalap wherein you are inspired by an allied raga and you deviate from that and then come back. So we know alapti today by two terms, tirobhav and abhirbhav. So I also want to point out that all of these things that I'm going to talk about, which come to us from the Sangeeta Ratnakar, are apparently evident in all of the forms of Hindustani music that are there today. There is a very big push these days to say Dhrupad is the oldest, everything else came later. And there's even an attempt to label certain forms as being Hindu and some forms as being Islamic. It's not the case. The history of India is one that promotes the idea of syncretism. So whether it is Dhrupad or Khayal or Thumri or whatever else that is sung, that is called classical, even Carnatic music, which I won't get into today, there are influences from various cultures that have come together and created these forms. So I will discuss a little bit further about when I talk about Nibaddha Sangeet, this is of course Anibaddha Sangeet, this is Alap. When I talk about Nibaddha Sangeet and Sangeeta Ratnakar, you'll find that all of the features that define these genres that are not Dhrupad are found in Prabandhagan. Meaning that Khayal, Thumri, Tappa, Dhrupad, all of these have basically come from the same source. And it would be very wrong to say this is older and that's younger, this is newer, that comes from this culture. It's all that classification is bogus. It comes from the same source. And it's important to understand that. Questions on any of this? Okay, so with regard to Nibaddha Sangeet in the Sangeeta Ratnakar, getting down to the idea of how you say a composition in Prabandhana, there are three particular features that really struck my eye when I was reading about this. First is the idea of Pratigrahanika. Pratigrahanika is the concept of singing free form in the raga and taking that and inserting it into your composition. it's not stated what kind of syllables are used in doing this, but Akar is a definite possibility. Akar is not something that is new to Indian music. It's existed from the very beginning. So just think about this. You're singing the composition, you intersperse some kind of Akar in between. That's not done in Dhrupad, but it's done in Khayal. Then there's the idea of Sthayi Bhanjani. That is, you take the composition and you depart slightly from what is laid out in the notation. Okay, so just as an example, if I were to take China. Composition is also not necessarily true. There was a leeway to change the composition here and there. But finally, the thing that really struck me is Rupak Bhanjini, where you can break apart the composition as long as you keep the words in place, but you can change the melody as you like. So the composition is not nearly as fixed as suggested, right? Established a composition first, but after that, as long as you keep the 10 raga lakshanas fixed, you can change the melody of a prabandhana. Questions on this? Yes, Anna. I'm talking about the Sangeeta Ratnakar written in the 13th century by Sharangana. So, and then more interesting things happen. So, we've all been told that khayal, the word khayal itself, is an Islamic word. It's an Urdu word. It is an Urdu word. But it's not clear whether it's just that's the only source. Thakur Jaidev Singh says that there was a precursor form that came out of Prabandhagan that was called Khelapada. So that Khelapada exhibited all of these characteristics that I'm talking about, and further it was limited to two parts, just like a khayal that is sung today. So is it possible that that Khelapada became khayal? It's possible. All I'm trying to tell you is that one should not take cut and dry answers about how things are. This is this way and that is that way is not the way to go about understanding the history of this music. The music actually is very interwoven across cultures. So I really want to drive home this point. And further, if you see how the genesis of khayal is prescribed, some people will say that it was created by Amir Khusro, who in the 13th century, early 14th century. Well, that's when the Sangeeta Ratnakara was written. Right? So there's an overlap in time when supposedly this new form of music was created and Prabandhagan was being written about. So therefore, it's very difficult to say that only one thing influenced Amir Khusro. Further, as some of you might know, Nayak Gopal, who was a musician in Vijayanagara, was brought to Delhi by Alauddin Khilji after Vijayanagara fell. And so you see that Amir Khusro had not only access to the music that he was bringing or the Islamic ideas, but he also had access to the music that was prevalent in South India at the time. So these forms that are considered to be precursor forms and very established and this is the way it is and so on, and see, it's Hindu and so on, it's not like that. There are multiple influences that were playing together to create the musical forms that we find in North India. There's one final interesting piece of evidence about how khayal comes about. So the reason why I'm bringing up khayal repeatedly here is that some people will say that khayal really became established in the court of Muhammad Sharangila by Adaran and Sadaran. There's plenty of evidence to suggest that it was an independent form of music well before that. In the 16th century, there are sources from the Pushti Malgi tradition that talk about a saint, is it Gokulnath, who goes to Agra to find provisions for the temple, and he discovers that there are these dancing girls in the streets who have attracted a large contingent of people around them, and people are very fascinated by the music that they're doing. And he says that they're singing khayal and tappa. So this man who comes to Agra from far away knows these terms also. He knows what khayal and tappa are. Because he's able to hear it and say, oh, they're singing khayal and tappa. So the idea that these were very elitist forms that were formed in court, not accessible to people, looks to be on shaky ground. There's another tension that I want to discuss that seems to be integral to the history of Indian music. There's always been a tension between the music that's done by the privileged classes and the music that's done by the common people. But the thing is, the tension is actually more a question of one form influencing the other and vice versa. So even in the time of Prabandhagan, he speaks about Prabandhagan being Margi Sangeet and Geetika being Desi Sangeet. So there was another form of music that he considered lesser, that was sung by the common people. And he talks about features of Geetika which are very different from this Margi Sangeet, from Prabandhagan. But he also talks about how he both the forms, you find common features. Then you go forward and you find evidence where people say, oh, there's a distillation of Prabandhagan that's sung by lesser musicians. It's called Dhrupad. And only the lesser musicians sing Dhrupad. And you go forward and you find, oh, there was, you know, there were the great Dhrupad years, and then, you know, there were Khayal years. And then you go forward and you find, oh, there's Khayal, and you know, the bad people do Thumri. And you go forward and you find, oh, there's classical music and there's Bollywood. So this tension has been always a part of the history of Indian music. But while the tension is present, it's also true that the one has always influenced the other. Perhaps in this day and age, one is influencing the other a little too much, but there are influences both ways. So getting down to what exactly a prabandha consisted of, there was an opening section that was free of tal called Udgraha. Then there was an intermediate section that allowed you to transition to the Nibaddha Sandhi, that was called Melapava. And then the fixed composition was sung in two or three parts: Dhruva, sometimes Antara, and then Apo. Dhruva, Antara, and Apo. There's a particular form of music called Salava Sudas that used this Antara. But otherwise it was Dhruva and Abhu. What did the Udgraha consist of? It consisted of invocations of the patron, rather honoring the patron, usually flattering texts that ingratiated the composer to the patron. Followed by the Melapaka, which consisted of praise that invoked holy deities of various sorts, to make the space holy before the actual Prabandha Gan was sung. As I said yesterday, an essential part of the Melapaka was the Tena, which is the chanting of the invocations. And as I discussed yesterday, the main syllables, the syllable grammars that are used to sing Alap and Jod in Dhrupad today come from an invocation of that sort. It comes from Om Tarana Tarana Hari Ananta Narayana. So, whereas the Udgraha was meant for the patron, that part has gone away, and the same set of syllables have now come into the first part of a Dhrupad performance. So what I'm trying to get at is that the alap is essentially is analogous to the udgraha. The melapaka is analogous to the jodjala or the nomtom, followed by the composition. Now, what are the interesting features of the composition? And my laptop dies, I need it. Okay, anyway, Dhruva. It's okay. Dhruva. Dhruva is the section of the composition that keeps repeating. So, what is the part of the composition that plays that role today? The sthai, right? When we do any kind of improvisational work, we come back to the mukhra of the sthai. And the sthai is repeated a few times throughout the composition. Then, the antara. What does the antara entail? The antara, as I discussed yesterday when I was talking about the alap, the antara is essentially representing the raga from a different part of the scale. So sa to sa and then pa to pa. The same idea is there, that you are presenting the composition from a different perspective, from the middle of the octave up. That was antara. And then the abhog, the two definitions of abhog, abhog and abhog. One meaning incomplete, the other meaning to take pleasure of. So some people will say to take pleasure of the raga, meaning not once you've established the raga, you move as you like in that raga, in the abha. I'll get to the other interpretation of the word in a second. But you can see that analogous parts of the prabandha now show up in the Dhrupad. Sthai, antara, we talk about sanchari abha. But when we sing a Dhrupad, the Sanchari and the Abhog are typically sung together in one section. We don't sing the Sanchari and then go back to the Sthai. You sing the Sanchari followed by the Abhog and go back to the Sthai. Meaning that section acts as one unit in singing a Dhrupad. So I hope you see that there are parallel structures that are happening between what was considered Prabandha Gan and what we consider Dhrupad today. Any questions on any of this? Either I'm being extremely clear or you guys are being very quiet. Okay, so let me... talk about different ways of presenting the Prabandhagan. So now we've talked about the five dhatus of Prabandhagan: Udgraha, Nilapakar, Dhruva, Antara, and Abhoga. Now there are four different ways of doing this. You can present two, three, four, or five dhatus. If you present two dhatus, you have to sing the Udgraha and the Dhruva. That means in modern terminology, the alap followed by the sthai, which for Carnatic musicians might look like a ragam, tanam, and a palli. Just one section. Three dhatus, meaning you have to sing the Udgraha, you have to sing the Dhruva and the Abha. So an alap followed by the full composition. Four dhatus, Udgraha, Milapaka, meaning the alap, jorjhala, followed by the composition, Dhruva and Abha. And finally, those compositions that had three dhatus, you'd sing the Udgraha, Milapaka, and all the three dhatus. So you see these variants in various places throughout Hindustani music and indeed through Carnatic music also. So all of this is circumstantial evidence to suggest that all of these things have migrated into forms in both of the systems of music. Okay? So as far as the compositional content, a Prabandha was expected to have, aside from Tena, it was expected to have Viruda, meaning the praise of the patron, which in Carnatic music today is known as Virutam, right? It's usually to a deity, but it's actually, in this case, it was meant for the patron. Then Pada, meaning the remaining text of the composition that could deal with whatever theme the fixed composition had. Parta, meaning the syllables that were extracted from the language of the drum. So if it was a Pakhawaj or a Madang or whatever, the language of the drum was part of the rendering of the fixed composition. Of course, the tala is an essential part of the fixed composition. And then swaras. Swaras were also used as part of the fixed composition. So in some sense, a complete Prabandha Gana looked very much like what we would in Hindustani music consider a chaturanga. It would have various ways of singing words, swaras, tala patterns, as well as syllables that are used in the tana or the tena. So, if one were to really try to understand when this form of music became the way it is today, the first documented Dhrupad actually comes from the 16th century. And the first sense of when things are codified in this form, it's usually credited to the reign of Raja Man Singh Tomar in Malwa, so in the 15th century. So, although people talk about Dhrupad being from the Samaveda and so on, really the evidence for the modern form of Dhrupad goes back to about the 15th century. Now, I want to talk about how Dhrupad looks from the perspective of the forms of Giti that there are. So traditionally they are considered to be five types of Giti. When I say Giti, they're different forms of Prabandha. But really, from the perspective of Dhrupad today, a Giti form is actually telling you what a Swara looks like in performance. So the five forms are Shuddha, meaning a composition that uses only the notes without any decoration. Bhinna, meaning that the note has been moved slightly from its central position. So what do these look like? So,
Ah,
kind of movements can be considered Shuddha Giti. Bhinna Giti. Coming to the note from some other position. Gaudiya Giti, meaning that the transition is covered by me. This is Gaudi. Vesara, meaning that there are gamaks that are cast movements that are associated with the notes. So now you see four different ways of approaching the note. Directly from a moved position with a long arc and with gamaks in between. Finally, the Sadharani Giti was that Giti form that used all of these. So a composition that uses all of these kinds of decorations is called Sadharani Giti. When you look at these Gitis and what comes after them, we get into a little bit of a controversy, because today when people talk about the Banis of Dhrupad, there's this idea that comes into mind that the Banis are equivalent to Gharanas. Banis are not Gharanas. Banis describe song forms that have a particular intent on how melody and time are related. What I've just shown you is how a note is treated. Now, how does a bani relate to that? There are four banis. Gohar bani. Gohar bani, the attempt is to try and give you a sense of timelessness. So although there's a rhythm, there's a movement in such a way that you lose sense of that rhythm in the composition. So that while the singer is singing, he or she is completely aware of where the tala is. As the listener, you should not feel the tala at all. Khandar Bani, where the gamak that is present in the composition is so strong that it gives you a very strong sense of how time is moving. So the tala becomes very evident. Further, because of the gamaks, you get a cross rhythm going, so you get multiple timelines happening inside the same composition. Dagar Bani. Dagar Bani, as we understand it today, is not Dagar Bani of the four Banis. What is sung today is better called Dagar Gayaki or Dagar Gharana. Dagar Bani originates from the idea of negotiating continuity throughout a composition, so that there are very few breaks in the melody. So you get a sense of a very expansive kind of form. And their time, the melody is not complex, the time is very integral to the melody, and you get a sense that the raga is just kind of an infinite entity that keeps moving. And finally, Nohar Bani is a form of music where you feel that the discontinuities are very great. So you keep feeling a sense of movement from one spot to another without clear musical ideas flowing in between. So you get a sense of jumps happening. So I just like to demonstrate four compositions for you in each of the banis. I also want to say that most gharanas today, whether it is khayal, dhrupad or whatever else, most gharanas have compositions of all of these forms in their repertoire. Where you lose sense of time.
Ra, ra, na, 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 na
Ah. And that offended Mia Tansen very much, because you only addressed him as Mia Tansen. Even if you were the king, you addressed him as Mia Tansen. So he wrote this as a rejoinder to that. Every line, every stanza ends with Re, as if he's saying Are to Agbar. And further he says, Shubha Mahurata Shubha Ghari Dino Baitho Takat Aaj Dilli Pati Narare. He doesn't say Narapati, meaning that the Dilli Pati is also Nara. So keep that in mind. So now Dagar Bani, in the sense of Dagar Bani here, Dagar Bani refers to a form of devotional music where the melody must be direct, it must be directly appealing to the heart. And the bhakti that is associated with the lyrics must be very clear. So I'm going to sing for you a composition that was tuned by our Chote Ustad, Ustad Ziafaruddin Dagar Sahib, but the words are from Nayak Baiju. And this rag is Tivra Nishad Durga. So it's Durga with a Tivrani. So Chote Ustad said that this is also called Purana Kalyan because there's a murchana that happens that you can suddenly hear a Kalyan coming out of it. So I'll try to demonstrate that a little bit before I sing the composition.
Thank you.
See that the continuity of the melody is what is important here. There's very few jumps. There's also this peculiar doubling that's happening. Right? The first line is in single, one syllable per beat, and everything else doubles. This is a feature that, again, Carnatic musicians in the audience might realize shows up in the works of Muthuswami Dikshita, for example. And there's one conjecture that Dagur Bani or Dagur Bani came from Swami Haridas, and in some texts, the Manhu Kutuhal, for example, that was written by Raja Man Singh, is referred to as Haridas Dagur. of Vrindavan, right? So, and Muthuswami Dikshita traveled to Varanasi, sort of in the same region of the country. So, one conjecture is that the Dagur Bani Paddhati is what came with Muthuswami Dikshita back to South India into Carnatic music, and his compositions reflect that Dagurvani format. Finally, there's Noharvani, and most people I've spoken to, they say that there are very few compositions of Noharvani available, because the main feature of Noharvani is to create jumps throughout the composition, throughout the singing of the composition. But the real thing that we're trying to get at is the element of surprise. There is also conjecture that Agra Gharana Dhrupad is Noharvani. I'm not sure about that. I think Agra Gharana Dhrupad is more complete than that. I think it uses all the vanis, just like all the other gharanas that sing, that have Dhrupad repertoire. But, so I don't have a good composition to demonstrate Noharvani as far as these discontinuities. I'll sing you a composition that I wrote that tries to incorporate the element of surprise in it, and it, maybe it's more from the perspective of the lyrics and the what's going on in the composition, but I think it'll give you a sense of what Mahalanabis gets towards. So in Raag Jokkons, which Sagar requested. Also, one thing I do want to point out is that there's a big difference in how Dhamar is perceived in Agra Gharana versus Dagar Bani. In Dagar Bani, the idea is that the taal is langra. You know, it's not an even taal. 5, 2, 3, 4. And so the vakraness of the taal is often reflected in the compositions also that are sung in Dhamar. And to showcase the vakraness, oftentimes the Dhamar is slowed down quite a bit. So the vilambit pieces that I think you were asking about yesterday, a lot of the vilambit pieces in Dhagirvani are in Dhamar, which is kind of counterintuitive to people who have studied Agra Gharana, where Dhamar basically is the celebration of Holi. So where things should be very energetic and fast and rhythmic. So this is written more from that perspective than from the Dhagirvani perspective.
Oh, my.
these are the four banis. But what I'd like you to really take home from this is that there are two things that are happening. The tala is being considered, the time is being considered from the point of view of continuity and discontinuity, and the melody is being considered from the point of view of continuity and discontinuity. And each and every combination is basically explored in these four banis. And so therefore, it would be kind of funny to say one gharana is just one bani. Every gharana has compositional repertoire from all of the four banis. And essentially, if you go back to what the Gitis are saying, most gharanas follow what is called sadharani Giti. They combine all of the aspects of how to treat a note and how time is related to the note. Any questions on any of this?
I wanted to ask, how are the Gitis and Banis related? For example, you talked about Gaur Bani. I felt that the Gauri Giti would be prominently used in that because you don't want to give the sense of time, so you just go through meanings and like that.
Correct. So the only thing, correct. So if you look at it, the mapping is pretty obvious. So Gauri Giti goes to Gohar Bani. Vesara Giti can be said to be like Khandar Bani. Dalevani is like Shuddha Giti. And Noharvani has aspects of Vesara Giti, it has aspects of Bhinna Giti. Bhinna Giti has very strong gamaks also sometimes. So some people say Bhinna Giti is actually the gamak. So you can say that that also associates with Khandarvani. But essentially what we're trying to say is that the treatment of the note will happen in different ways throughout any given composition. Right? But one of the Gitis will predominate in a composition, in one of the Banis. But a Bani essentially projects majorly one form of Giti, but incorporates various aspects of these Gitis. Make sense? Yeah, please.
So this is also related to what you said yesterday about there being five main sound producing centers, Nabhi, Kantha, Rudra, and these sound centers, are they used equally for all parts or Gitis? Or, for example, Gamaka, is it easier to produce through one center than the other?
Depending on the depth of the Gamaka, it can be either Nabhi or Rid. I mean, you can create a shallow Gamaka with the Kantha also, but Nabhi or Rid is usually where it comes from.
So I wanted to ask about Sat. On the Pakhawaj. I noticed what you were playing now was there was no simple teka in any avartan. Is that most common or?
I'll let Kishan speak a little more about it, but from the singer's perspective, the objective of the Pakhawaj is not to keep the teka.
Mm-hmm.
The objective of the Pakhawaj is to accentuate the chanda
like
of the composition. Similar to what? Yeah, in fact, similar to what Palghat Maniyaya used to do, specifically, his bani. That's essentially the role of a mridanga.
So, accompaniment has the way I've never been taught formally from a Pakhawaj player how to do sangat, but whatever I'll share with you now is whatever I've gotten from Guruji, how he's guided me. So, basically, after attempting to have multiple conversations with multiple Pakhawaj players across the board, there is no one hard and fast rule about how to accompany. There are some Pakhawaj players who will say, "Arey, pata hai ki kitne avartan baki hai. You know how many avartans are left in this thai? Ek paran laga lunga. Just play a paran or something. Ho gaya kaam. Simple set." Then there are some who say, "Nahi, usse kaam nahi chalta hai. There's still something more to it." And I am from the latter, and I've been trained to think of the latter. It's not as simple as squeezing in a fixed composition in any given period, which suffices to be a part of your sangha. So as Guruji just mentioned, it's my job to accentuate what he sings. So if you observed, as he was demonstrating each of the four banis and each of the four compositions, agar maine, when he sang Khandar Bani and sang the Suhabis, Shubham Amrit, if I use that style against Ekasamai Radhika, it won't work with it. As an accompanist, it's my job to understand what he's trying to do.
And this goes for anything. It's not just for Pakhawaj and Dhrupad. It goes for Khayalias also. It goes for Tumri singers also. Sangati aisi cheez hai. I have to try to boost to whatever capability I can what he is singing. For which I have to have a very good understanding of what my instrument is capable of doing. So, for example, when Guruji was singing the Khandarvani or even the Noharvani, you heard lots of if I use that for something like Eka Samay Radhika, it won't work. But the reason it worked is because I'm meeting his vigor level. Right? So as a Sangatkar, it's my job to, this is from just the Bharav perspective. Okay? Bharne ke liye, I have to understand the rigor and match that rigor. Not get in the way of that rigor. But match that level of rigor and just boost it a bit. Okay? Second thing is, there's Dagarbani mein, the way they play Pakhawaj, and how I've observed, like listening to recordings of Pandit K.G. Ginde, S.C.A.Thar, Pinkerji, people like Arjun Sheshwal, and then there's two different methods, right? You noticed in Niranjan Nirakar, there was this point of absolute silence where people thought that Arey to khatam ho gaya, taliya bajane lage, right? But the idea is that Dagar gharane mein, Dagar gaiki mein, those silences are very crucial to the expression, to the execution of the music. It's not about Bharavar. It's just as long as he's singing, I'm playing. If he's not singing, I'm not playing. To the contrary, when you listen to people like Shejwalji, you see that the you can't tell exactly what they're playing. But you get the sense that wo dheka ko bhar rahe hai. They're not playing the exact gat, dhe, ta, dhe, ta, dha, right? But they're filling those gaps in while keeping the division of that theka the same. That fill-in depends on what's being sung. Now, in the last couple of days, I thought, like, okay, how do I talk about what the accompaniment process is? Basically, as the bandish progresses, the accompaniment and the bharavat gets more and more and more and more filled. The caveat to that is, if the antara or something, antara vese, like you observed in some of the pieces he sang, they start at the top full of power. So I have to start that way, and I have to go somewhere with it. Now, I'm not, that's one thing which is my weakness. I don't know how to start fasting, start energetic and keep that energy going. Mujhe aata nahi hai theek se. But in many cases, the bharavat of the theka of the tal happens according to the progression through the composition. If it's a four-line composition, then you progress, you fill it more and more and more and more and more through those four lines. And you repeat that process from the sthai to the antara to the avogan sanchan and back. So that circular notion keeps filling. What do you fill it with? There's the Pakhawaj grammar, which I'm not going to get into. But Pakhawaj ka apna ek grammar hota hai, jisse wo bhara jata hai. And so, does that make sense, what I'm saying?
Yeah. So, if you reduce the line to say, 30, you mentioned the number, it would be about
30, 30,
30. Yeah. Tab, same logic.
Vahi, same logic applies. Now see, that's a very dagger thing to do. To take a Dhamar or Dhrupad that slowly, because you want those breaks. You want those pauses. Exactly. It'll remain chanchal. If I try to fill in everything that he's doing, then while he's trying to create this sort of shan, sort of feeling with his music, and I'm sitting there going, kar, dhi, ta, trak, dhi, dhi. Ah, if I start doing that, then it'll go exactly against what he's trying to do. Right? So in something that slow, where he's singing, I'm playing something to match it, not to reach ahead.
Other thing I would say is that, like we talked about yesterday, the guru nature of the instrument comes into play. So if a composition is pulling something at a very slow pace, right? If there's a lot of mean work or it's happening at a lower tempo, the resonance of the instrument is part of the sangat, right? Whereas if you are doing like dhum machi hai or something like this, what he's playing is actually cut. You know, it's not nearly as long. So you allow the resonance of the instrument to also match what's happening with the main line.
Like we were talking about yesterday, how the sangat, the instrument's tonality, plays a large role in it. It just comes down to that. Because the Pakhawaj is such a resonant instrument, it fills up a lot of space. And it doesn't need to do more than that. If the as is less, if the resonance is less, you have to fill it. There's no choice. But if the as is there and the resonance is there, then you don't have to put so much effort either.
The question was actually, because there is so much ask, why do you have to build so much?
To match the rigor. Because if he was to sing something much slower, and
see this, we'll just take Heka Samman, we'll just play Heka. Complete, right? Whereas even in that tempo, if he's matching the chand of the composition, you know, you're correct. What he's creating is a sense of he's giving a sense of the time in between by marking
because
it.
Because you are marking it very clearly with the bandish, so he's able to go off the mark.
Correct.
And that also depends on the bandish itself.
Right.
In a bandish like Eka Samay Radhika, where the, it's supposed to feel timeless,
mm-hmm.
my sangat has to feel equally timeless. So that's how that mood gets. Wahi aise hi bana jata hai ki jo mahol hai uski. So if he sang Eka Samay Radhika, and that's what I mean by understanding the instrument. Many Pakhawajas and many people have this assumption ki agar Pakhawaj bajana hai to. Aise hi Pakhawaj bajta hai. Then there's some people who feel like Pakhawaj is only.
Again, it's coming back to the same idea that we talked about yesterday, that dynamics are a very important aspect of what's going on.
This is the sustain of the instrument, which no one can be sustained.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
We have been speaking about compositions on bhakti love. Are there compositions on war, number one? And second one is food. Food. Cooking and food.
Food. I am not aware of any compositions on food.
I've come across precisely one. It's not a Dhrupad, it's a Bada Khayal Raag Malkons. If you open Kramik Pustak Malika, the Mukhra is Paana Bidi Banake. You can look that up. It's there in Kramik Pustak Malika.
Yeah, and also there was one khayal in Tilakamot in Sinhalese that I had gotten once. Madhura Amarasade. It was about Amras. But other than these, I don't know.
The first one was war.
War, yeah, there are compositions on war. Taranas, no, Taranas are different. They're not there in Dhrupad. But like I showed yesterday, you can use the Dhrupad format to teach, you know. So in that composition, I put some Taranas in it. On war, there's that Adana composition. Just give me a couple of, give me a minute here to. Thank you. okay, well, it's there. I have to find it. There are quite a few, actually. Oftentimes, again, there's this conflating of Hindu characters with the king. You remember it? You want to sing it? Huh? Sing it. Can you give him the mic?
This bandish
has various versions. There's one recension in which Sri Ramachandra is replaced by Shahir Aurangzeb. But see how interesting that is. So, like, even a figure like that, who is considered to be very, very Islamic, anti-Hindu, and so on and so forth, he had this kind of composition sung in his court. Where he's being conflated with Ramachandra. So things are very fuzzy. Today we have very, you know, very clear ideas of this is bad, this is good, this is this. But actually, if you look at history and you look at history through this medium, things are very fuzzy. So, but in response to your question, yeah, there are numbers of compositions that deal with.
Something called Bharani. So, where a poet stands on the top of a hill and observes two war friends, and he writes his poem based on what is happening, and he uses hard sounds, so to explain the intensity of the war which is happening. So I was thinking whether there is something similar to that.
So often these compositions are dealt with, they're dealt with from a Khandarvani perspective, with very heavy gamas and so on. So, you know.
Siri, Raghuvir, or Shahe Aurangzeb, Chadhat Ghode, Indra Asanahiyo, Airavat Taramalo, Sama Sama Palaimilo, Paniya Ghode.
So, this kind of a thing, I mean, the way sort of that martial feeling we brought in would be through Gamas. That's why in the composition yesterday, you remember the composition? Raja Gobar Har. Fauzdar Khandar. Khandarvani is the general. So there's already a martial association there. Yes, sir.
I was wondering if you could speak a little bit on Rag Bhava, because in all of this there are several Panis, and in Khayal Sangeet where I've heard a lecture demonstration of Binde Saab saying that koi bhi bhavam, we can create any bhava from any raga, it's not necessary. Is that the same idea in Dhrupad?
Yes, it is. In one word, it is. I remember there was one particular occasion where I was asked to sing. I've never done this afterwards, but I was asked to sing in this venue which was extremely noisy. The sound system was very bad. They took me through, with the audience sitting there and chatting away and eating food and so on, they took me through sound check, and then I was very upset. And I was told I sang a very angry yaman that day. So any rag can convey any emotion. How you do that is by using appropriate ornaments. So let's see if I can show. Opportunity to describe how I do Dhrupad. So what I'm going to do is try and convey the full meaning of the composition to you. So in order to do that, what we have to understand is that the sahitya ek samay radhika mukha na banaye ang chali sang shama juke. So what is it saying? One day, Radha, in her excitement, without putting on any makeup, without putting on nice clothes, whatever, she rushes out to meet Shyam and to go with him. And he sees her and says, Kara Shringar Rupa Vano, Sihari Mukha Ko, Dekh Ke Swarupa Ko, Chandra Hula Jaye. So, in whatever Shringar you have done, seeing that, even the moon is put to shame. Okay, so that's the sahitya. So that's what we have to portray. Now, one thing I want to say immediately is that there's a tendency these days in doing upaj where what is sung is nonsense, right? Eka sama, this kind of thing is done a lot. That's not appropriate upaj for Dhrupad. By any means. Dhruva pada, meaning the central idea is the composition. So when you do upaj in the composition, you should never lose the meaning of what is being said. There are core ideas that you can keep expanding. So I'm going to basically start with the core and then nest up.
Ah, yeah.
Whatever mood is embedded into the composition, it will come through the raga. What Gindeji says is completely correct. Whether I can produce an angry Jayajavanti is probably it's questionable. I don't think I can. But the point is that whatever the pada is that you're taking, you want to be able to feel the rust that is there. And so if I take this approach to Paratha Lanka, it's not appropriate. Right? I should feel whatever emotion is embedded. So this idea is so important, and somehow it's completely lost in how we do, how most people are doing upas these days. Answer the question.
Last So the star talap of a Dhrupad is typically longer than what we usually hear in a khayal, I mean significantly longer than what we hear in khayal. So given that's the case, that has to be generic, right? I mean, you haven't even introduced a composition. So how do you treat that? Because
from the bhav perspective?
From the bhav perspective, because what we, the way I've learned in khayal, it's so short, it's maybe 2 or 3 minutes, it's 4 or 5 phrases. But when you show the entire rag before you introduce a composition, what are your...
I would say that rags are very much like people. And that might be a bit of a cliche, but I'll explain it a little further. So, every person is capable of a series of moods, right? But you typically meet people who have one predominant kind of mood. You meet happy people, you meet sad people, you meet angry people, you meet whatever. And a rag tends to have one emotion that stands out further. And so, when you're doing alap, you sort of start to sink into that emotion. And you know, one has to treat ragas appropriately in the sense that there are also people like, in the sense that you meet some people, you know, you can talk for hours and hours and hours and keep discovering new things, and there's so much to talk to about. And then there are other people, like you can have a 5-minute conversation and you don't want to continue it. Rags are that way. If the rag only speaks to you for 5 minutes, you should only present it for 5 minutes.
But if you have two compositions with different moods, opposite moods in the same rag, would your choice of the composition that you're going to present affect the star alap there?
I think what would happen is, as I'm saying the alap, the composition would suggest itself. I don't think I'd start off thinking I want to sing this composition. I would start off seeing what the rag has to say to me today. And then the composition would suggest itself.
Is there... In Nomtomala, is there, you get to do things, explore the rag, which you do not in with the composition sometimes?
Yes, absolutely.
So then do you, can that be a differentiation, that
yes.
You discover the rag in its totality in the ragala, and then the composition binds you to a certain, you know?
Absolutely, that's a very good point actually. So there are two ways to approach this. One is, exactly what you said, that you start off without any preconceptions and you take the raga in the direction that it wants to go and you explore to the depth that you want it to go, and then there's a composition that presents one facet of the raga. There is the opposite tack that you can take, which is that, okay, today I want to sing this composition, and then the raga suggests itself out of that. And I think especially in the Agra Gharana, correct me if I'm wrong, there's one of the methods of teaching rag was to learn a lot of compositions. And then in learning all those compositions, you get various angles and facets of the raga. And so if you're thinking of a particular facet of the raga, the composition will be there for you. But you're absolutely right that alap, jorjhala or the nontum alap, that gives you the space to go in whatever direction you want the rag to go. And then what happens is, as you're presenting the composition, some of those ideas actually will come in, even if they're not part of the composition, they'll suggest themselves in different ways through the composition.
Since you're doing the alap for a significant portion of time, let's say 45 minutes at least, and then you move on to the bandish, you wouldn't again want to start with the slow elaboration. So it is more or less like the upaj in khayal, where you move into a slightly more faster pace and the play with lay takes a little more predominance. So there the bhav then again becomes very different, because in vilambit khayal you have the luxury of elaborating slowly, similar to what you do in ala. But the bandish is already there while you're presenting. So
My intent in presenting a composition is always to highlight the content of that composition. So as Arijit said, you've taken the liberty of exploring the raga to its full extent in the 45 minutes. Now a particular facet of the raga is captured in this composition along with a sahitya that has its own purpose as described by the composer. So you have to be true to the sahitya and convey the meaning of the sahitya in your padhat, in the composition. So my Bharat philosophy when it comes to Dhrupad will be very different from Dhruva Khayal, because my lyrics are driving me. But having said that, there is one thing that I want to say. I think of our music in three dimensions really: Tala, Raga, Bhava. And in my mind, Dhrupad, Khayal and Thumri actually use each of these quantities as the independent variable. Dhrupad is organizing you from the perspective of time moving through the piece, right? From zero time, like no sense of time, to an implicit time, to an explicit time, to a counted time, right? So Ala, no sense of time, Jod, implicit time, pulse introduced, Jhala, that pulse becomes more insistent and explicit. Then the composition where the Tal is actually counted for you, so the time becomes a strong bound on you. With Khayal, what is being explored is how the Raga unfolds, the various sanchars of the Raga, where one has to stop, the Vadi Sambadi, the Vishranti points, the phraseology around those points. Those are unfolded gradually in Khayal. Right? The Tala is given, the Tala is going at its pace, whatever it is. And the Bhava is there, but you're really interested in what the Raga is telling you in Khayal. And you unfold it that way. In Thumri, the Raga is there, the Tal is there, but you're working on the Bhava. So each of these elements which together bind our music together, each of these acts as an independent variable in each of these forms. That makes sense. Does it make sense? But having said that, when you come to Dhrupad and you come to the composition, then you take a very, you take an approach where the bhava of the sahitya is what is central in the development. Anything else?
I was wondering if you could give us, as students of music, some things that we can practice, perhaps. Because there are several students amongst us, things we could do at a very practical level.
I think it would be very nice to come back and do another workshop. There's a lot to say on that, and it would be doing injustice to the topic if I just said one or two things. The fundamental riyaz is to make your voice strong, to really have control over the three octaves, to understand how to throw your voice in each of those octaves, to understand that neither crooning nor screaming is part of the equation. To understand that the panchasthana are there in every nad that you produce in the process of making music. Through this instrument, the panchasthana must be integral in that process. It must be integral in thinking about that process. The rest is, of course, there. Yes. Anything else? Thank you.
Come to a close. On behalf of everyone, I would like to express our heartfelt gratitude to Shri Arijit Mahalanabis for accepting our invitation and giving us 2 days of his precious time and treating us to this wonderful discourse on Dhrupad and Dhamar. Thank you so much for all the intricate details and the subtle nuances that you shared with us. And most importantly, clarifying all the misconceptions prevailing in the audience about this art form. Thank you, Kishan, for supporting and accompanying Dada on the Pakhawaj. I would like to request Mrs. Sudeshna Dasgupta to honor the artists on our behalf with a small token of our love.
Thank you.
also like to thank Professor KVS Hari, the chairman of EC department, for allowing us to generously use this platform for exploring the art form. Last but not least, I would like to thank one and all gathered over here for participating and encouraging us and making this event a grand success. As Aarambh celebrates its first anniversary on Feb 5th, we keep you posted on further events. Thank you, Balu sir, for all the technical help. Thank you once again, and good night.